First, if we can, let's get a status update. How much did you sleep last night, and where do you think things stand this morning?
Yeah, we got a few hours of sleep last night, but we're back up and at it, working hard, because we know that working people need a voice in Washington, and this race is too close to call. It was ruled out by a lot of folks a long time ago, but we just worked so hard with our grassroots army to have conversations about the type of country we want to have.
I want to look at glass half full and glass half empty here. Glass half full. This is a district where President Trump won by 11 points in 2016, yet right now it's within 1 point. It's a race that the Republican incumbent before had won by, I think, more than 30 points. So how did you swing so many votes to the Democratic side? How did this happen, and what does it tell us, perhaps, about trends across the country?
Well, we talked to voters where they were. We talked to voters in their, coffee shops. We talked to voters in their homes or their doorsteps. Having a conversation with regular working people about how they pay their mortgage, how they have a safe and secure retirement, how they can afford health care access. That's something that works. That's a conversation that working people want to have. And we had it all over every part of this district, all seven counties.
Glass half empty view here is you are 1,700 votes short so far. There are still more votes to be counted, but right now you are trailing. And if the trend continues, it will be Troy Balderson who wins over the next several days. Is there anything you can look back on and say, man, I wish I had done that differently?
No, because we're proud of what we're doing right now, and we always knew that the fight would continue on August 8th, because we have an election in November, and we feel great about the conversations we're having right now. We'll be out campaigning today and having serious conversations with voters about their future, about why their family needs someone who's going to fight for them in Washington, about why they need someone who's going to stand up for health care access. And that's what we want to do. We feel great about where we are, though.
There are some people who look back and say, well, you have said you will not support Nancy Pelosi should you become elected there as the next speaker or Democratic leader in the House. When you're speaking to Chris Matthews, you said if she was the only Democratic candidate, you would be supportive of there. Without getting into the exact analysis of that statement, a forensic analysis of that statement, what does it tell you that support for Nancy Pelosi is so toxic among some, not all, but some voters?
Well, it tells me the folks are ready for a new generation of leadership, that families want to see Washington deliver some type of actual solution for the things that they're dealing with. And I'm running to be an independent voice in Washington. I think a difference between me and my opponent is he's going to do whatever Washington, D.C. tells him to do. I'm someone who's going to be an independent voice. We need new leadership desperately in Washington, D.C., because if we're going to take on the problems of not just the next few years, but the next few decades, we need folks who are going to be looking to put forward serious solutions on that stuff.
If you can, take a step back for us here and look at this race as a political analyst right now. There's a huge urban-rural split. And it is the type of thing we've seen all over the country. When I say urban, I mean more urban, Franklin, Delaware counties, where you did very, very well, and those other counties, the more rural counties, where your opponent did very well. This split seems to be widening, and not just in Ohio 12, but across the country. Why?
Well, that's something that we need to solve, because too many people are being divided, too many people are being pitted against each other. The problems of a family in Franklin County, when they sit down and they talk about how they're going to pay their mortgage, how they're going to afford their rising health care costs, how they're going to finally get a raise at their job, those are problems that families in Muskingum County, in Zanesville, in Mansfield, in Morrow County, Marion County, Licking County worry about. I know that because I grew up in rural Ohio, and I know that Democratic families, Republican families, rural families, suburban families, and urban families, when they sit down around the kitchen table at night, they're usually worried about the same thing. They're worried about rising costs of health care. They're worried about folks like Troy Balderson who want to raise the retirement age and cut Social Security and Medicare. And that's something that's important to me.
Do Democrats need to do a better job delivering that message to some of these rural counties where they haven't necessarily picked up steam over the last several months?
Well, I'm hopeful that everyone who's running for office will have a conversation with working families about how they're going to fight for them and how they're going to let them secure their version of the American dream. This is a country that can be greater than we are right now. We can do better than we're doing right now. We need to have the backs of working folks. Folks ask me, why I'm running for office. It's because there are families who get up every day. They get their kids on the school bus. They clock into work. They come home. They help their kids with their homework. They do everything right, but they don't have anyone fighting for them in Washington. And that's what I want
to
do.
Let's talk about President Trump. He came to your district really at the last minute to try to prop up your opponent, Troy Balderson. The president thinks that may have helped, may even have been decisive. What role do you think it played?
Yeah, I don't think he knows what he's talking about. You can fly in, hang out here for a couple hours, fly out. You don't walk on our roads. You don't have kids that go to our schools. You don't deal with the public health crisis with addiction that we have here in our state every single day. I think it's more important to have grassroots conversations. And Troy Balderson can have all the people he wants fly in from D.C. I don't think it makes too much of a difference. I think that the reason we're having so much success and the reason this race is a tie ball game right now is because we've been crisscrossing this district, talking to voters about important issues, about stuff that matters to them when they sit around the kitchen table.
You say the president, I don't think he knows what he's talking about. You don't believe that his message has some resonance in, again, some of those rural counties in your district?
Not based on what I saw. I mean, we were out talking to voters that day, the days after, and when I stand on someone's doorstep or I meet them, in a coffee shop or just walking down the street, one thing I like to ask folks is, what do they worry about? What keeps them up at night? And it's rising health care costs. It's the thought of having their Social Security or Medicare cut. I think that our voters and the American people are much smarter than we give them credit for. These are folks who recognize that we have problems in our country, but these are problems that can only be solved if we send new leadership to Washington. And that's why I'm running.
Let me ask you one mechanical question before I let you go. If the margin shrinks to less than 0.5%, there's a mandatory recount. If it's greater than that, and who knows where it will land when these provisional and absentee ballots are counted, will you ask for a recount?
The only thing I know for sure is that I'm going to be campaigning every single day until November. The mechanics of the recount and all that stuff, with this race being too close to call, we need to make sure that every vote is counted, because when people exercise their right to vote, that needs to be respected.
Any final message you want to deliver to perhaps President Trump, who I think was calling you Danny Boy from the stump on Saturday night?
Well, Danny Boy, I think that was the first song I ever knew. It's a traditional Irish song, and I think Danny Boy's actually a compliment, so I'll take it in stride.
All right, Danny O'Connor, the Democratic nominee for the Ohio 12th Congressional District as it stands this morning and perhaps going forward to November. Thanks so much for being with us this morning.
Thank you. Have a great day.